Hi, I'm volcanologist Dr. Janine Krupna, and this is my guest.
I'm Jeff Renner. I served as chief meteorologist and science reporter at King Television. That's the NBC affiliate in Seattle from 1977 up until 2016. Still do a lot of work talking about atmospheric sciences and the environment even to this day, and yes, volcanoes as well.
Thank you so much for joining me for this Melting Helens 40th anniversary video. You were there. You were there leading up to the eruption. You were there during the eruption and after the eruption, and you were reporting on it. You were seeing what the people were going through. So leading up to the Mount St. Helens eruption and before, what was the public perception of volcanoes and hazards, and how did that change leading up to the eruption? What are the things that have stuck with you over the last 40 years?
I think it was multi-level. There were some people that were inevitably fascinated with these volcanoes in their backyard, but as I think in many areas, there were people that had come to take Mount Rainier, Mount Baker, Mount St. Helens for granted. They were just something that had always been there, and I was always amazed by the number of people that had never visited any of these. But I think to really get a sense of that, you need to go back to the mid-70s when Mount Baker started to get active. There was increased steam emissions, and there was a lot of research being done. Scientists started suggesting that precautions might be wise to take. And so people were taking this in. It never progressed to the point that there were major limitations. But I think they were at a point where when Mount St. Helens got active in 1980, they thought back to Mount Baker in 75, 76, 77 and thought, well, wait a minute, there were all these precautions issued, but nothing ever came of them. So you had a tendency on the part of some of the public to disbelieve that. And as a science journalist who at this point was spending time by the week, if not even longer, down at Mount St. Helens, we actively worked with the scientists to talk about the basis for their projections, how they were developing new understandings, new techniques, and continuing to do research by the day to understand why this needs to be taken so seriously.
It's such a critical relationship to have as science and media and the communities. So how was it for you having the perceptions there, trusting the scientists? Did that help? When did that change for you?
Well, I think it really started back in 78 when I accompanied Dr. David Johnston from the U.S. Geological Survey, Dr. Steve Malone from the University of Washington and others, because I saw firsthand in the crater of Mount Baker the amount of work that they were doing, the knowledge that they had, and their dedication not only to their research communities, but also toward the safety of the public. So I had that within me. When we were getting ready to go down to Mount St. Helens, I made a trip over to the University of Washington bookstore to pull out every book I could on volcanology. Now that's not my degree field, so a lot of that was over my head, but I just wanted to have a sense so I could ask credible, sensible questions of the scientists and give them a sense that I had done some homework to try to understand accurately what they were doing and what they wanted to get out there. And of course, part of it was to establish rapport and credibility with the public. So there wasn't a lot of work that was necessary for me to believe what the scientists were doing because we were covering it. We were seeing it day in and day out. I think as in anything, personal relationships are key. Whether it's from the science community getting information out and trying to motivate action on the part of the public or scientists working with the media or vice versa. And so I really tried to establish those relationships. And I would have to say the scientists that I worked with day in, day out were very generous with their time in establishing relationships also.
We saw with time through leading up to the eruption, there started to be some pushback from people wanting to go to the volcano.
Oh, yes.
And we know that the outcome could have been very, very different had the eruption happened at a different time. So, you know, we still see these issues today with not necessarily people trusting the scientists. So what's your view now for 40 years back forward? Looking back at the situation of the general feeling of what people were, how they were dealing with this long-lived unrest that was lasting for several months, trying to make personal decisions and trying to listen to who was talking.
Well, I think there were a couple of aspects. Number one, there was a tendency because it wasn't convenient to disbelieve the cautions and suggested actions that the scientists were mentioning at that time. You had people that said, well, it's my personal right to go where I want and to do what I want, and a lot of pressure to go into cabins, properties that people owned at that time. It may not be well known, but at that particular time, there was a lot of pushback by property owners who had heard wild stories of everything from hippies to Sasquatch going in and tearing apart their cabins. So the then governor of Washington State, Dixie Lee Ray, finally responded to that pressure by enabling a caravan of property owners to go in escorted by county sheriffs, county sheriff's deputies, state troopers on that Saturday before May 17th. And I would say I had been away from the volcano for 2 days. I was asked to go back down there. There were probably 150, maybe 200 people would be my rough estimate of those that went in. There was supposed to be an identical caravan the next day on May 18th. If the volcano had erupted just 1 hour later, the mud flows, the debris flows, all the different things that occurred would have totally wiped out those people that were assembling and all the local officials, the law enforcement officials that were trying to keep them safe. So instead of a death toll of 57, you would have easily had 157, 257 or something of that sort. I think, ironically, had those warnings been fully absorbed and fully adhered to and honored, you might have had just one fatality. And that fatality would have been Dr. David Johnston, who was on a monitoring station on Coldwater, doing his job. And I think it shows the cost and the potential cost of ignoring the warnings of scientists who have done the work and have the knowledge.
So at the 40-year anniversary, I have two more questions. First is, what would you want people to know about Dave, who is there, you know, trying to understand the volcano, trying to help people? And what do you wish people would take away from this anniversary?
If David were here today, and I wish that was the case, he would be the first one to say, no, I'm not a hero. I was doing my job. I was doing something I love. But he was a hero in terms of not only applying himself through his science, through his fascination with volcanoes, with the Earth's processes, but also being very dedicated to getting that information out to the public so that they better understood what the hazards were and what the foundation was for the warnings that were being issued at that time. I think the other thing that I remember, and I always smile when I think of him, was his absolute infectious enthusiasm. First time I met him was in the crater of Mount Baker, as I've mentioned. And we're there, there are steam vents jetting, you know, some sounding like jet engines roaring around. There was yellow debris, and he said, oh, that's sulfur, and there was orange debris and deposits, and he said, oh, that's arsenic. If we go closer, we need to wear gas masks. I'm intimidated, and this was my first time on any big mountain, and yet he had this infectious enthusiasm that he just went about his testing as if he was preparing morning coffee during breakfast, and that infectious enthusiasm just caught. And so I would say, use David as an icon for understanding the backstory behind the scientists that are doing the work. There's a fascination, there's a dedication, and there's a lot of hard work and risks, either in terms of opinion and pressure or in terms of actual danger. And we see that day in and day out. So I'd say, in terms of understanding David Johnston, the best honor that we could accord David would be toward extending that respect that we would have for David posthumously to the other scientists that are working in so many fields these days.
Thank you so much. It is a pleasure to have you with us. Thank you for your time. I appreciate you being here.
It's been a pleasure talking with you. Thank you.